My name is Adejo Sunday. We'll be continuing our discussion on the course theories of international relations post 311. In previous sessions, we have tried to understand what international relation is all about. We tried to look at the rationale for the study of international relations. We have also looked at the actors in international relation. And in the last session, we discussed some concepts in international relation, concept of bipolarity, unipolarity, deterrence, multipolarity, foreign policy, diplomacy, and of course, national interest. Today we'll be discussing approaches to the study of international relations. This is very key as far as international relation is concerned. We need to look at those approaches. As its name implies, approaches to the study of international relations. What that means is that while studying international relations, there are certain modus operandi, there are certain ideas, there are certain conceptual constructs that one needs to understand to appreciate the study of international relations. Approaches are tools that enables one to understand, to explain, and to predict phenomenon. And so your understanding of international relations and international politics is dependent on how well and how much grasp of approaches and theories that you know or that you have. The more of these approaches that you know, the more of these theories that you know, the easier it is for you to understand and make critical analysis of the politics among nations within the international system. So, like I said, approaches are instruments or tools that enables one to understand, to explain, and to predict. Approaches are, to a political scientist, what the hammer is to a carpenter, or what the saw is to a carpenter. This is the tool that we use for analysis. This is the tool that we use to enable us to understand, you know, the dynamism of the international system. And so, a political scientist without knowledge of approaches is not a well-baked political scientist. And so, this topic is very, very important. And so, in the study of international relations, there are several approaches, just as there are several theories and several models, you know, that can enhance one's knowledge of the study of international relations. We have the traditional approach, we have the behavioral approach, and of course, the post-behavioral approach in the study of international relations. Under the traditional approach, you have the legal approach, the institutional approach, normative approach, historical approach, and of course, the analytical approach, which all falls under the traditional approach to the study of international relations. And so we start this discourse by taking a look at the traditional approach to the study of international relations. Just as its name implies, the traditional approach is one of the oldest approaches employed in the study of international relations. And this approach employs, you know, legal, institutional, normative, historical, and analytical tools to understand the behavior of states within the international system, to understand the nature and character of the international system, to understand the dynamism, and of course, the uniqueness of international relations, and of course, the attitudes and interaction between states within the international system. Okay, so having said that, the traditional approach is the earliest and oldest approach in the study of international relations that employs legal, institutional, normative, and historical approach in trying to understand the international system. And so to appreciate the traditional approach, you must isolate each of the sub-approaches used under the traditional approach. All these approaches put together forms the traditional approach. But before we discuss each of these approaches, it is important to state that the traditional approach is called traditional because this approach is not scientific. This approach does not make use of scientific methodologies. That is why it is called traditional approach. Regardless of the fact that this approach is traditional, this approach is not scientific, this approach is not based on empirical evidence, doesn't debunk the fact that this approach is not a viable instrument for understanding global politics. It is. Knowledge of this approach will enhance your understanding of international politics. But like I said, Its potency does not lie in the fact that it's not empirical, and that for the fact that it's not empirical does not mean that this approach is not potent as far as understanding, you know, international relation is concerned. And so let's take a look at the legal approach. The legal approach is that example of traditional approach to the study of international relations that attempts to look at the behavior of states within the international system in line with international law. There are laws, there are modus operandi, there are codes of conduct that binds and regulates the behavior of states within the international system. And this falls within international jurisprudence, if you like. And so the legal approach will try to look at the behavior of states within the context of international law. As states adhering to international law, many states sign treaties, they sign memorandum of understanding, but do they adhere to this? Do they keep to the principles of pacta sunt servanda? And so that makes this approach very, very important. More often than not, the behavior and actions of some states is challenged on legal grounds, whether or not those states whether or not their action is in line with international law or with international status is what the legal approach attempts to look at. For instance, some people have said the U.S. invasion of Iraq is a violation of the sovereignty of the states and therefore a violation of international law. Such perspective is based on legal approach. Okay, let's take a look at Nigeria, the crisis between Nigeria and Cameroon over the Bakassi Peninsula. Of course, there have been series of crises until finally the International Court of Justice ruled in favor of Cameroon, and eventually Nigeria adhered to the ruling of the International Court of Justice. And so if you want to do an analysis of that situation, you need to employ the legal approach to the study of international relations. Quickly, the institutional approach is that approach in the study of international relations that attempts to look at the role of institutions in international politics. Institutions are key instruments within the international system. States are some of these institutions, and apart from states as institutions in global governance, you also have institutions like the United Nations, like ECOWAS, like the European Union, and so on and so forth. These are institutions that play a critical role as far as international relation is concerned. And so the institutional approach is that approach that bases its analysis of international relation on the role of institutions within the international system. What role does the United Nations play as an institution within the international system? United Nations have played critical role in terms of peacekeeping, in terms of international security, and of course in terms of other humanitarian assistance, just like the AU, the ECOWAS, the EU have also played critical role. Now you talk about the normative approach. This approach derives its analysis by identifying existing norms within the international system. And so there are certain understanding that you must have of the norms and values of a particular state before you can do a critical analysis of the relationship between that state and other states. I give you an instance. Recently, we have been having crisis in Myanmar, what is popularly called the Rohingya Muslim crisis. How will one do this analysis without having an idea of the norms and values of the various ethnic groups that exist within Myanmar? So, how would one also talk about, for instance, the clash of civilization as propounded by Samuel Huntington in his popular article? You know, that gives an idea of norms and values of people within the international system. And so certain analyses need to dwell on norms. And that is why we said this falls under the traditional approach. Then you have the historical approach, a very interesting approach, an approach that bases, you know, its analysis on the role of history in understanding international relations in the past, in the present, and of course, even in the future. History is a very important tool that can be used to have a better grasp of the nature of the trends and dynamism and dimensions, you know, of global politics. For instance, Santiana would say, he that despises history is bound to make mistakes of the past. It was Professor Inoue Kaige who once asserted that for Africa to move forward, the continent must be understood backward. And so that tells you how important the knowledge of history is. You know, the world is changing, the world is evolving, but the knowledge of history is very important. How do you avoid another world war? We have had First World War, we have had Second World War. Will there be a Third World War? I don't know. But for us to avoid a Third World War, we need to avoid all those factors that led to First World War and Second World War. And so the knowledge of history of what has existed ab initio is very, very important. And that's why you have, you know, the historical approach. Then the analytical approach. Analysis is very critical to one's understanding of international politics and international relations. And so what the analytical approach does is to bring in deductive and inductive reasoning to examine, to interrogate, and of course to do a prognosis and a diagnosis of happenings within the international system. Analytical approach is a very beautiful approach because it helps a lot as far as understanding, you know, the behavior of states within the international system. The second approach is the behavioral approach. The behavioral approach is the opposite of a traditional approach. At the beginning of the class, we said the traditional approach is not an empirical approach, that this approach is not scientific. But the behavioral approach is a scientific approach, and that shows, you know, the trends and the need for scientific evidence, the need for empiricism, pragmatism, and factualism in the study, you know, of international relations. And that is why you have the behavioral approach. The behavioral approach, like I said, is an antithesis of the traditional approach. This approach is an attempt to make the study of international relations a scientific field of study. And so the behavioral approach adopts scientific methodologies in analyzing, in understanding the trends and dimension of international relations. Now, instruments like statistics are employed in the behavioral school or by the behavioral school. The behavioral school employs scientific methodologies like observation of data, collection of data, classification of data, hypothesis, experimentation, you know, theories and law. All these are approaches that are employed under the behavioral, you know, approach to the study of international relation. But like I said, most importantly, that this approach is empirical. This approach is based on facts. This approach is based on evidence. This approach makes use of scientific methodologies. It was David Easton who tried to also give us some characteristics of the behavioral approach when he talked about systematization. He talked about verification. He talked about pure science, value-free. He talked about verification and all of that as the basic characteristics of the behavioral approach. To end the class, the last approach is the post-behavioral approach. Remember, like I said earlier, that for the fact that the traditional approach is not a scientific approach doesn't mean that it has lost its potency. It is very important that we have knowledge of the traditional approach, and all these approaches we have discussed under the traditional approach are still very much important and potent even in the 21st century. And so what the behavioral school or the post-behavioral approach is about is a blend of the traditional approach and the behavioral approach. And that makes it, for me, a holistic approach that employs both normative, institutional, historical, legal approach, plus empirical approach to understanding, you know, international politics. Now, to make a good analyst, one must also be able to apply each of these approaches as far as understanding and examining global politics is concerned. So when we come in the next session, we are going to look at theories of international relations proper. Remember that the course is theories of international relations, and what we are doing, we are appetizing you, and we are gradually getting to the nitty-gritty and the thrust of the course. That is what the next session is going to be all about. So ladies and gentlemen, I see you in the next session. Do have a blessed day. I remain yours faithfully, Adejo Sunday.